Well, as you casted your vote for the best chili, you made a decision, and I was thinking while I was sitting up here, we're going to start off the service with I'm resolved, and I think, have you made a decision to serve the Lord? Have you made a decision wholeheartedly, downright, just whatever it takes kind of a decision that you're going to serve Him and follow Him in your heart and your mind tonight? Let's sing this song.
I am resolved no longer to linger, charmed by the world's delight. Things that are higher, things that are nobler, these have a Lord my sight. I will hasten to Him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to Thee. I am resolved no longer to the Savior, leaving my sin and strife. He is the true one, He is the just one, He hath the words of life. I will hasten to Him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to Thee. I am resolved to follow the Savior, faithful and true each day. Heed what He saith, do what He willeth, He is the living way. I will hasten to Him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to Thee. Whosoever surely meaneth me, surely meaneth me, oh, surely meaneth me. Whosoever surely meaneth me, whosoever meaneth me.
Let me share something real quick, Linda. This is a happy song. Okay? And while I was looking at this song and listening to it this afternoon, I did a little bit of research. I don't know if you notice, because we don't use our hymnals a lot, but at the bottom, well, always at the top, first of all, it has some kind of scripture related to that song, which I love. And at the bottom, it has who wrote the song and what year. So, who wrote this song? His name is J. Edwin McConnell in 1914, okay? In 1922, he had his own radio show, and it was titled Hymn Time. And he was such a happy man that they called him Smiling Ed McConnell. And if you look at his picture, he is smiling. He is so happy. This is supposed to be a happy song. Think about it. Whosoever meaneth me means you, every single one of you. This is what our eternal salvation and our joy comes from.
I am happy today and the sun shines bright. The clouds have been rolled away. For the Savior said, whosoever will may come with Him to stay. Whosoever surely meaneth me, surely meaneth me, oh, surely meaneth me. Whosoever surely meaneth me.
before we go to prayer. I found this little saying. I'm going to share all kinds of stuff with you guys tonight, but I found this little saying. It says, when you bring your natural, God will bring his super, and it'll become supernatural. And I think about the song that we're going to do in the name of the Lord. That's where our strength comes from. And I'm so glad tonight that even in my worst times and even just throughout the day, guys, not even when it is the worst time, but praising him and thanking him, that all I have to do sometimes is just speak his name.
Bible, the disciples were taught that there was something about the name of Jesus, and that there was salvation, and there was strength, and there was healing. It's all in the name of the Lord. As we go to prayer, let's go thanking the Lord. This is one of the greatest times of the year. As we approach the Thanksgiving and Christmas season, I enjoy every bit of it. And people are running to and fro, and families are trying to get together, and we're battling that too. And I told Brenda, I said, Brenda, you're a good cook. I'm going to have turkey and dressing no matter what they do. So if they come, I'll be pleased. And if they can't come, it'll just be more for me and you. But let's really enjoy the season. Don't allow the cares of this life to pressure you into hoping and praying that Thanksgiving and Christmas would be over. It's the greatest time of the year for the church and the Christian. As we go to prayer, let's remember the Warner family in our prayers. Regina Thornton in our prayers. Remember John Parsons in your prayers. Rosemary Shank. Continue. Remember my brother. He's doing better, but holiday seasons are tough when you lose a loved one. Purse Singers, let's remember them. Diana Jarrett is home recovering from eye surgery, and so let's remember her as we pray. And some of you are facing some surgeries coming up. We certainly want to remember you. And are there spoken requests tonight? Okay. Yes. All right. Any others? I just remember that family. They buried his mother today. We were down to funeral home, and they're doing well, but still, that's tough. So, Andrea's grandmother had tests done, and they thought she had cancer, and she does. It's in her lungs and in her lymph nodes, and she's raised Andrea. She's been a mother to her. And so remember Andrea's grandmother when you pray. Any others? I'm sure that we all have unspoken requests. Heavenly Father, what a wonderful privilege to know that, Lord, you don't forget a name. You know our needs even before we ask. You're able to supply them. You're God. There is none else. Nothing too hard for you. Nothing impossible with thee. And Lord, as we enjoy this Thanksgiving and Christmas season, help us in our attitudes. Help us in our thoughts to realize the privilege it is and the cost that you paid that we might be partakers of the divine nature. Be with our nation, be with our military people and our policemen and Lord, our firemen and all the unrest across our land. Help them to realize without Jesus there is no peace, but you will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed upon you. Be with the Warners, the Thorntons, be with John Parson, Rosemary Shank, be with my brother Ray, the Persinger family, the Jarrett family, and Lord, the many others that are standing in the need of prayer. Oh, how we love you tonight. Oh, how we lift them up, spoken and unspoken requests, Lord, in prayer. Do for them what they can't do for themselves. And we'll give you the praise. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Ushers, if you'll come. Brother Steve Buster, would you bless me? Announce the winner of the chili cook-off at the close of the service tonight. Something to look forward to. Don't forget choir practice following the service tonight. And then Friday afternoon from 3 to 4 will be visitation, and 4 will be a memorial service for Charles Neal Jr. that used to come here and be a member of the church many years ago. We'll be doing that memorial service, and Howard and Chuck Ledman will be singing in that Friday memorial service. So please keep that in mind if you're available. It says, in loving memory, Charles Neal Jr., November the 18th, from 3 p.m. visitation, family and friends, 4 p.m. memorial service. I don't see my singer here tonight, so sure can. Yes.
Well, God took care of him. The young man, the father of the child, has good godly parents. From what I understand, they're like workers in the church, and they just, you know, are good godly people. And he's a chaplain for the firemen, and I work off in the area where they live, and has a big church. And anyway,
amen. Amen.
God,
yes.
God is when we pray and we talk to God and have intense prayer, God answers our prayers. He hears and answers prayers.
Yes, he does. Praise the Lord. Yes. Amen. Amen. Anybody else have a praise report you want to share with us? It's always a blessing to witness that. Anyone else? Don't everybody pop up at once. Amen. 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 Good testimony. Praise the Lord. John. Amen. Amen.
That's God thankful to be saved 46 years now. So I'm thankful to God that He's reached out and picked me up, and it's been a joy ever since.
Amen.
Amen. I recommend it highly.
So do I. Ditto. Anyone else? They overcame by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. Well, for the solo tonight, and you don't have to get worried, I'm not going to sing, but I was handed a great piece of paper that I want to pass on to you. It's interesting. I want to tithe, a man told his pastor. I want to give 10% of my income to my church. When my income was $50 a week, I gave $5 to the church every Sunday. When I was successful in business and my weekly income rose to $500 a week, I gave $50 to my church every Sunday. But now my income has gone to $5,000 a week, and I'm having trouble. I just can't bring myself, keep looking up here, to give $500. The pastor said, well, why don't we pray over this? Dear God, please make this man's weekly income $500 a week so he can start tithing again. That's pretty good wisdom, isn't it? Huh? I want us to look at the words of Jesus in the 6th chapter and the 38th verse. This is the Thanksgiving and Christmas season. And believe me, once the dinners start and the celebrations start, before you know it, they'll be over and gone. So I want us to look at what Jesus is teaching in this verse and the lessons that he gives throughout the scriptures. He says, give and it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, and shaken together and running over, shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure that ye meet withal, it shall be measured to you again. The text reveals tonight in the teachings of Jesus the law of giving and getting, sowing and reaping. The Apostle Paul told his churches, remember, if you sow sparingly, you'll reap sparingly, because you reap what you sow. Jesus is teaching in this verse choices and consequences of giving. I ask you tonight, there's two kinds of people. I've been in this a long time, full time. There's givers and there's takers. Which one are you? There are certainly more takers than what they are givers. It's amazing to me how people care nothing or little for the church until they want something from it. And then they expect and want the church to fulfill their needs, whatever it may be. It's amazing to me how people try to use Jesus as a Santa Claus. Do you remember when he was feeding the 5,000? He looked at them and said something that was ironic. I'm sure they didn't like it. That's one of the reasons why they wanted to have him killed. He said, you are following me, but not for the right reasons. You're not following me to hear and learn my teachings. You're here for the fish sandwiches. You're here to be fed. And I thought, well, Lord, that's true today. God is blessing our church and giving us resources. And when we have a big feed, they come out of the woodwork and fill their plates. People I've never seen, you know. It's good advertisement for the church, but they're not coming because of Jesus. They're coming to fill their belly with free food. And so Jesus kind of addressed that lesson as to the choices and the consequences of giving. I want to talk to you for just a moment on the gift of giving. The gift of giving. Don't let it pass you by this month and next. Giving and being able to give to those who are in need is a gift. Now I ask you, which is the greatest blessing in your life? I want you to think about it. When somebody gives you a gift and says, I appreciate you, and they give you a gift of appreciation, you're thankful for it. And it makes you feel good. But how does it make you feel when you see somebody in need and you have the means to supply that need, and you either do it anonymously or you go to your friend or family member and say, I want to do something for you, and you give? Which is the greatest feeling in your life, getting or giving? There's a gift in giving. I think that's why God gave his son. I think that that's why Jesus gave his life. As I was thinking about the Thanksgiving season and the Christmas season, my mind went automatically to a story. I love stories. I'm getting old and I'm forgetful, but boy, I can remember these Bible stories. And my mind went to the third chapter of the book of John. And in 10 verses there, it tells a wonderful story about the gift of giving. So many people are caught up in getting. And if they don't get what they want, they're despondent, depressed, discouraged, and sad. But if you're a giver, you go away blessed. Jesus said, give and it'll be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. According to your thoughts and capacity to give, the same shall be measured unto you. I like to listen during the holiday season. In fact, the other day I had a little time on my hands and I closed a book that I was reading down there at Books A Million, and the mall became crowded. So I walked out and sat on a bench, and I thought, I'll just observe and listen to what people say as they go back and forth. And as I listened and I observed, I came to the conclusion that most of them were not into the giving part. They were into the getting. And I thought, how sad that many times, and even in the church, we miss the blessings of God because we've not experienced the gift of giving. Peter and John were going to the temple in that third chapter of the book of Acts. Well, now that's a pretty good thing to do around Thanksgiving and Christmas, is to go to church. People want to get things from God. They call the prayer chain every day, wanting everything in the world. I don't even know them. I haven't ever seen them in church. But they want God to do this and this and this and this. I let Brenda handle that. The gift is in the giving, not in the getting. And these two men went to the temple, and they went there to pray. What do you go for? As we said earlier, a lot of people go to eat. One man told me, he said, well, preacher, I'll tell you why I'm coming to your church. I'm looking for a woman. I said, well, keep coming. We've got a few of them. And of course, much to their dismay, I kind of helped him along, you know, and dropped some hints. But that's the wrong reason to come. What do you come to church for? I've seen people that very seldom come to church until they get in trouble. Keep looking up here. But when they start getting in trouble in their marriage or their home, they hightail it to the church. But these two men were going to church and they were going to pray. And Peter noticed a lame beggar on the temple steps, temple called Beautiful. And he said to the man, look on us. You know, I thought about that and I thought, well, Lord, what do people see when they look on us? And when they listen to how we talk, what do they see? Are they reminded of Jesus? People may forget what you say, but they'll never forget a kindness that you show. And Peter and John said, I want you to look on us. Well, immediately, that beggar looked their way. He had a tin cup, expecting to receive some money from them. Expectations are killing people today. They expect somebody else to do for them what they need to be doing for themselves. They come expecting a handout instead of a hand up. I had a lady that asked for the pastor and she was displeased with what I told her. She was wanting money, she was wanting help. And I talked to her a little bit and she didn't like it. And she said, well, what in the H am I supposed to do? I said, I don't know what you're supposed to do now, but I can tell you what you should have done. If you ain't got no money to get where you need to go, you should have stayed home. We are one of the most giving churches that I've ever pastored. I commended our church board last night. In fact, most of our business was giving to others. And we never lose on that. God is blessing the church. But this man expected to receive a material gain. It blew him off of his shoes when Peter said, silver and gold have I none. But such as I have, give I to thee. Those two preachers didn't have much money. But they had something far more valuable to give to that man than what he ever realized. Do we realize as Christians what we have to give to a world that's without and the world that's hurting and the world that needs help? We've got much more to give as a Christian and as a church than what we realize. We're to be lights. We're to be witnesses. They ought to be able to see Jesus in us. We ought to be able to point them in the right way. And Peter said, such as I have, give I thee. And he told the lame man about Jesus. And he grabbed him by the hand and said, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. The man's ankle bones received strength. He began to leap and jump and praise God. And before all the people, the miracle happened. In the name of Jesus. The gift of giving. Little did that beggar know when he stuck out that tin cup expecting to receive a little money, what he would receive from men who love God. We're going to church to pray. And they prayed for him. And the miracle happened. The Bible says that the people were filled with wonder and amazement. Isn't that what Thanksgiving and Christmas is all about? I told Rocky Ellswick today at the funeral home. I said, Rocky, I am so thankful that you got saved before your mother went to heaven. And he said, Pastor Bauer, I am too. Because it brought such joy and tears into her life, knowing that I had found the Lord. Is there anybody in here that's giving the report for the chili fest? Okay. Are they on their way? Tell them I'm ready for them. I'm a short-winded Bible study man. This Thanksgiving and Christmas season, purposely, it don't happen by accident, purposely decide to give the gift of giving. Come right on. We're ready for you. And then you can close in prayer.
We just want to thank you all for supporting us. And we raised $268 tonight. And put you on the spot. You can tell what a, these are our vote for spicy. Well, who knew, who wrote spicy? Look at this, spicy.
Who puts an E in spicy?
Yeah, who puts an E in spicy? Who won? Tell us first and second place. Spicy.
S-P-I-C-E-Y.
Okay, for the most spiciest, we have Lori Gibson in first place.
Yeah!
And in second place, we have Sam Pearson.
Yeah!
One vote difference.
One vote difference.
Tell us the mild winners here. Sawyer?
Okay, for the mild, the first place with 13 votes is Shelly Gaines. And in second is Linda Barnett.
With 12 votes. One vote difference. So, again, we want to thank you all. As you do, sponsor us, support us, and pray for us. God works in mysterious ways. TJ, would you close a prayer for us? If you all stand, and when TJ's going to pray, we'll
use this thing.
We'll be finished. You can use that thing, buddy.
Okay. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to you in prayer, please put the full armor of God and all of Jesus' blood around us, God. Keep us close to you. Just keep our souls saved. And be with the pastor and his wife and Mark and his wife and everybody. Be with me at school and everybody here, God, and help me with my music and my struggles and problems and everything I face, God. My driving. Be with, you know, president, new president coming up, God. Just guide him in the right way and just bring this country back to you. Thank you for all my family, God. I love them. And I love my church family too, God. Help me have a good Thanksgiving break because I'm really looking forward to it. get a week off from school. And, but God, thank you for letting everybody here to have the money to go to school because not everybody has enough, you know, all the money to go. Thank you for letting me have a good education. Thank you for my mom and dad for letting them raise me in church, God. I love them a lot. And me and my dad and my mom have some good times together, God. And I thank you for blessing me when I was a baby. Just keep me close to you, God, as I go forth in life and help me in college. I'm kind of nervous, but I know you'll be there with me, God. Just watch over us tonight and help us get some sleep tonight and watch over us as we wake up tomorrow. Hopefully we can. And we love you. We give you praise and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Choir practice.